part 2 of episode 21. This episode is going to be dedicated to our predictions for Royal Rumble weekend, NXT TakeOver, and of course the Royal Rumble pay-per-view. Once again, joined by Anthony and Nick. We are here again to talk about our predictions this time. So, after that fairly interesting week of WWE programming, now we will talk about the NXT TakeOver San Antonio card, which was put together fairly quickly. And of course, because of this, we don't have any storylines to really hold on to. And it just seems rushed, but I can forgive it because I have faith in the fact that the talent will still show up. It will still produce very good show, very good matches.
I think it'll still get a quality reaction from the audience, and there's a lot, like you said, there's a lot of talent there.
I don't think NXT needs storylines right now. I mean, I'm not saying it doesn't ever need storylines, but for what is happening right now because of the circumstances and the shows and whatever and the traveling and the breaks, it doesn't necessarily need storylines. They could just put the guys together that are good and say, you know, fuck it. You know, let's put a match together. We'll see how they do at the show. First match on the card. I don't know if these are official.
The official order.
The official order, yeah, the official of the card, but this is what people on the internet were posting, so I'm assuming this is important. So we have Roderick Strong versus Andrade Cien Almas, and I actually think this is going to be a good match. I think this is going to be pretty solid. Two guys that are very good talents. I don't know. I honestly don't know.
I'm gonna go with Roddy
just to go with Roddy. I love Roderick Strong. I feel like they're building him up very slowly.
They're gonna try to make him a good mid-card main event or mid-card babyface.
They are building it that way. And after the attack last week, well, this week rather, that it kind of alludes
that seals the deal. Yeah, you get attacked. And once again, that segment was put together almost the entire last episode of NXT was put together strictly to just further the matches
a little bit.
Yeah, just to promote them, just a smidgen, just to get something on the card.
Because Lord knows they've only had a couple weeks to build this shit. Yeah. Man.
And 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 matches on this card.
That's same as every NXT card.
Oh, really? Yeah. Okay. I thought this was underselling.
It's never more than like 6, because, I mean, think about it.
2-hour show,
there's
by the way.
There's not a whole lot.
Yeah. I don't even know there's been an NXT card with 6 matches on it.
Well, yeah. There might be one.
But
there might have been one with 6.
Yeah. It's amazing that these NXT shows have been good with less than 8 matches.
Yeah, 3 title matches, so you're going to draw them out and do it with 2 hours to eat up the time.
So are we all going to go Roddy?
Yeah.
So we're all going Roddy? All right, so Roddy's beating Cien Almas. We have Eric Young versus Ty Dillinger. So Canada versus Canada once again. I can't wait for them to not fight each other. They're going to politely tell each other to get out of the ring.
Yeah.
But I will go with I'm going to go with Ty just for the simple fact that he's been building up this whole I've lost it gimmick.
Yeah. Same reason I'm going with Ty, too.
Yeah, absolutely.
Plus, I think he's going to roll that win right into being number 10 at the Royal Rumble, so...
if they do not make him... We'll talk about the Rumble.
Yeah.
Actually, you know what? I'll save that for the Rumble. Sorry. Yeah. So, are we going to go with Ty? All of us are going with Ty?
Yeah, we're going with Ty.
I wanted to say Eric Young because of the whole Sanity gimmick, but I feel like Sanity won't really suffer from the loss.
No.
It's more of... It's more fuel for Eric Young to go on with Sanity... And to pretty much say, you know what, that's it. I'm tired of, you know, I'm not going to get beat again. And that's where his gimmick takes off.
Yeah.
Fatal 4-Way match for the NXT Women's Championship. So we have Nikki Cross versus Asuka. Right?
Wow. Fuck you, dude. We have what's Nikki this? Cross versus Asuka
where you're going
versus
with
Billy Kay.
Oh, I forgot all about Billy Kay and Rolls Royce. I totally missed the boat. On these two broads.
This is honestly, as far as I'm concerned, probably the most interesting match, like on the card. Seriously. Because everything else is kind of one-dimensional, but I mean, whatever. I'll be the first to predict. I think Nikki Cross is going to take it.
I think they're going to keep this Asuka machine going.
I think so too.
In all practicality, they probably will, but I would like to see. I'd like to see Nikki Cross take it. That could set up for Asuka to take it back.
Yeah, I don't see that her dropping the belt unless she's getting the call up. So
I mean, she can't remain undefeated forever.
Well, there's one thing we could all agree on with this match. I know that Peyton Royce and Billy Kay will not be tired after this match because they will be getting carried the entire time. By two actual athletes.
Billy Kay like, is a fine female wrestler.
I feel like they just put Billy Kay and Peyton Royce in this match just because they're chicks. I feel like
you haven't seen a Billy Kay match ever up until now ever.
I did see her play against the Minnesota Lynx the other day, and she was great. She put up about 30 points, had it. Good triple-double on her the other day.
Dude, if you're going to make a WNBA joke, you should probably do it in season.
Yeah. It's over
that's,
now.
That's cute. That's real cute, man. I'm pretty sure she had a lot of momentum going into the Takeover
Totally,
Dallas.
Totally. She could really drive
and
the paint
why,
very
that's
well.
That's why they chose her to introduce everyone.
I'm sorry. I don't buy this. I don't know what it is about these broads doesn't sell me on the gimmick. If anything, out of the two, if I had to pick, it'd be Peyton Royce. I don't give a shit about Billy Kay.
Based off of what?
She does look like a basketball player. She looks like a...
They have the same stature. Like, they're the same height.
I think Billy's taller.
They have the same height and the same build.
Billy looks like Slenderman, dude.
They're both 5'8", and they both have, like, a thin build. Like, I don't know where you're getting this shit from.
I don't know, man. I don't buy it. I don't know what it is about these broads. I just can't buy the situation.
I don't love them, but I don't hate them either.
I think Billy Kay is fantastic. I've been saying this for a year. You'll have to excuse Jose. He's retarded. All right. So, moving on. Well, who do you guys think?
Asuka.
Unless she's getting the call up, I don't see her dropping the belt.
We all think.
And I think it's going to go to Ember Moon eventually, anyways. So.
Yeah, I could. Yeah,
we're all going
to
go.
I would like to.
We're all going Asuka, but Nick really wants to see Nikki Cross. I
wouldn't hate it if Nikki Cross won, but I just don't.
I think she needs more time.
She needs more build. She's still the sanity. She's doing sanity stuff, so it doesn't feel
I think she needs to be away from sanity to win the belt. But
yeah, that'd be cool.
No. She doesn't need. But she's off the heels of sanity stuff, so she needs to establish herself. We have to see her wrestle before we can see her win the belt.
Yeah.
The tag team match, NXT tag team championship match, the office of the scholars of discomfort versus DIY.
I'm torn on how I think this match is going to go.
It could go two ways. The authors could win, and of course, DIY is stuck in the whole climbing babyface gimmick, or they could win, and the authors of pain think up another strategy. I don't really know where to go with this one either.
Considering TM61's out for the foreseeable future.
6 to 9 months.
And the Revival already kind of ran their course with the whole thing.
They were supposed to have a match on this card, by the way.
Yeah?
It was supposed to be TM61.
I thought you meant the Revival.
No, it was the next feud for the Revival.
I'll say I'm going to go with the authors, you know?
Scholars.
Yeah.
I was going authors up until I was just looking at the card now, and I thought about it. I think I'm going to go DIY, because the authors have to lose at some point. This would be their first loss. It would be on a big stage, which is where you would do a big loss, a big first loss. I'm going to go DIY. Plus, they're still super popular. You need a big, something for NXT to hang their hat on.
Yeah, but I mean, if DIY wins, that kind of, like, delegitimizes the authors, like, whole dominant, like... No one's supposed to beat them. They've been built as this unstoppable force, right?
But at some point, everybody gets beat.
I know, but I could see them getting beat after they take the titles. Like,
I guess
DIY is a super underdog team. They've been a super underdog team. It'd be really weird if they just go over. Like, who else?
Yeah, that's true. And I guess it'd be better for them to have the rematch. Yeah, okay, it makes more sense.
You know?
I'm going to go DIY for the simple fact that I don't like the Authors of Pain. I really don't.
Well, it's
don't.
Not who you want to win. It's who you think is going to win.
Yeah.
It's the point of prediction show.
I'm going to go with DIY. I'm going to go with they're going to get their first loss. Because I feel like...
You mean Oh, yeah, never mind.
Okay. Yeah, DIY's going to win, and Authors are going to lose.
The way you said it confused them. I'm sorry.
No, DIY's going to win it, and what you just said, the Authors have to face their first loss at some point. I do agree it might be a little early, and I do agree the scenario might not be, but that's also a little biased on my part, because I don't really want to see DIY lose the belts.
I don't want to see them lose it either, but I mean, if they go over to the Authors, and who else are they going to feud with? More authors? Like, it doesn't make any sense. Like, where do they go from there? There's
not enough scholars to fight with.
There's not enough tag teams.
Nah.
You don't have TM61, and then, if the Revival gets the call up, I mean, the Revival's been back and forth with them, so you can't recycle that storyline.
You know what? I think I'm going to lean towards DIY winning for the simple fact that they haven't really had any time with the belts. I mean, they won at the Takeover in Toronto, okay?
But they're a good underdog story, so you could still just...
They're an amazing underdog story, but I feel like their title reign has only been through flashbacks of Japan and, you know, Melbourne, and we haven't really seen them. We haven't seen them on television in forever, so we don't know anything about this title run. It's just been two guys that won the belt, and yeah, that's cool. What are they going to do now? They can't cut promos because they haven't been on television, but I don't know. I guess to really... hold down the tag division, you're going to give it to the Authors because you do need a solid heel to combat the big baby faces, and I understand that from a booking aspect, but I also haven't seen DIY as champs. I've only seen them as...
But their championship reign doesn't matter as much as their underdog story does, so...
That's also true.
Do it again in a rematch setting, so...
But it felt like they won the belts.
And then they become two-time champs and overcome the Authors and all that good shit.
It felt like they overcame the odds yesterday, you know?
But if they're going to do it that way, in the meantime, they have to start making more viable tag teams for them.
How about this?
Maybe Damo or... I don't know.
Who's Damo?
Killian Dane and Alexander Wolf can be a heel tag team.
And then they can Sanity can have all the gold.
I think they would be dumb to not go that route at some point. Really, like, let them be a big heel and hold it. There's only three belts to hold. There's four people, so...
Yeah. That doesn't sound like a bad idea.
That would be perfect.
That doesn't sound like a bad idea.
I was gonna mention that when we were talking about the women's title, but that slipped my mind when you said that, yeah.
Or you could go with a DQ finish and protect both. So...
That's a possibility.
I mean, that would be an easy cop-out, but... In the situation we're in...
It'd be an unsatisfying...
Yeah. It'd be very unsatisfying, but in the situation...
It'll definitely stretch it out,
It'll definitely stretch it out, one, two, it'll protect the fact that you don't have...
Have more than two teams?
You don't want to relinquish the tag team belts that you just gave to your biggest baby faces for the heels that, you know, haven't really established that they could clash with champions yet. So you protect both, but... We'll see eventually. So, what are we... I'm going to go DIY, just for the simple fact. Actually, I like the DQ idea. I'm going to go DQ.
You're going to go DQ finish?
DQ finish.
I guess it doesn't matter who wins at that point on DQ finish.
Yeah, I'm going to go DQ finish.
Yeah, I already said I'm going Authors.
You guys are both going Authors,
right? Swayed me back to the Authors. I'm going to go Authors, too, because it makes more sense.
Two Authors, one DQ finish. So, basically, DIY doesn't win at all in any situation. But, NXT title match, Bobby Roode versus Shinsuke Nakamura... solely built together out of both names. It's really been just, you know, this whole break really hindered this build.
It hindered every build.
It hindered
the women's build is the only thing that's kind of had any kind of real, like, substance
to it. That was only in the last 2 weeks. Like, Bobby Roode is literally just the next guy in line. That's it. There is no legitimate, like, rivalry or hatred or feud between these two guys. They're just the guys.
Yeah.
So,
I believe strongly that, and I hope they don't let me down, but I'm going to say this with a lot of confidence, that this takeover is going to be... The build was very underwhelming. There was no build, virtually any build. But I think that Triple H told these guys, or is going to tell these guys, look, there's no build for this. You really have to...
Yeah.
Bust your ass out there. Yeah. So Bobby,
and I'm sure they will. I'm sure they'll deliver.
Bobby, this is a title match, dude. Yeah. Like, Bobby's not the greatest in-ring technician, but he really needs to whip his dick out. Yeah, he really does
because his style and his finisher and everything. He's not all very, gimmick. It's not very impactful.
He's a very gimmicky guy. This guy's a walking
theme song and a room.
Yeah.
That's what it is.
That's what's been getting him by, and the fact that Bobby and I liked Bobby Roode even in TNA. Yeah. I mean, we love Bobby Roode's heel run in TNA back in 2011. Bobby Roode
won the title. That was great.
It was a good time for TNA, but then again, at the same time, just like now, his in-ring work was never stellar. Yeah. He's just a good character.
He's a good hand, but he's not like. There's nothing man. Like over. Yeah,
you bastard.
The greatest wrestling backhanded compliment. but there's nothing like. There's nothing exciting about what Bobby Roode does in the ring.
No.
He'll put on a quality match, but there's nothing,
He doesn't do anything unique, you know?
Yeah, there's nothing unique.
He's very vanilla in his actual in-ring style.
Which is kind of ironic, because he claims to be the it factor of, of formerly professional wrestling, now sports entertainment.
Yeah.
So, I don't know. What do you guys think?
Nakamura retains.
Yeah,
same thing with Asuka. Nakamura doesn't lose the belt unless he's getting the call-up, so... I'm going Nakamura.
Nakamura definitely keeps
it. Nakamura keeps the belt until there's a proper build for this.
Yeah.
There needs to be a proper build for him to lose it and Bobby Roode to take
it. I mean,
over.
And it could be, it could be Bobby Roode again and another takeover, but.
So,
They could Samojo this thing and have him go back and forth.
Once again, this is just. This is not the big takeover is still yet to come. It's going to be in Orlando.
Yeah.
So that's where all the big moves are going to be made. Bobby Roode still has enough
but
time
all,
to.
All the takeovers should be big, though, because they don't run a lot of them. They really back themselves like
no,
that.
But with
they
the
only
next
won
takeover,
like six a year, right?
With the next takeover,
less than that, I think.
Yeah, but probably with
the big four.
Yeah,
and maybe a fifth one. I don't.
Maybe yeah.
I don't know. Who cares? In between, who knows? But basically, the big takeover.
Well, obviously, the big one's gonna
is
be
coming up in about
well,
2 months. So
yeah, NXT Brooklyn's been pretty popular. I think the Brooklyn show has been is their show.
Essentially, the WrestleMania show is the big one.
Yeah, I think the Brooklyn crowd's just better.
Brooklyn crowd's the Brooklyn crowd is a lot better, but that's technically.
I don't know if I agree with that. I get what you're saying because it's happening on WrestleMania weekend, but
they've been better, obviously, than the WrestleMania shows.
I think the NXT Brooklyn show or the pre-SummerSlam show. I think they're going to keep it in Brooklyn.
It's been great.
Yeah.
They've been phenomenal.
It's the show that it's going to be like there. Because it was their first, big show. So
Nakamura stays champ. Pretty much everything follows the protocol. We're all very iffy about the tag team match, but everything pretty much follows protocol and stays what it is because there's really no build, and you don't want to lose your belts over a break and a couple of scattered, you know, promotions of the matches. So now we move on to the Royal Rumble 2017. The easily most out in the dark Royal Rumble I've ever been a part of. This whole lead up to WrestleMania is very, very silent, very mute. There's really nothing to talk about.
They've done a really good job of keeping
this
under wraps.
Yeah. In the world we live in, I wouldn't doubt that Vince McMahon or somebody put out an APB that said, look, shut the fuck up. Dave Meltzer, shut the fuck up. Brian Alvarez, shut the fuck up. PW Insider, shut the fuck up. Everyone needs to shut the fuck up, okay? We have something planned. We don't want anyone to know about it. Now, to the Royal Rumble show itself. Two shows on the pre-show. And the reason I'm talking about the pre-show is because why are these matches on the pre-show? We have Nia Jax versus Sasha Banks. Sasha Banks was embroiled in the most revolutionary rivalry of all time last year, and now she's on the pre-show with Nia Jax.
Yep.
Nia wins because she's Nia Jax. I don't know what else to say about this match.
Unless they try to rebuild Sasha to look strong, but I feel like that ship has sailed. So
yeah. It's a shame. It's a real shame how Sasha Banks has fallen so far from grace here.
Yeah, it's Nia's time now.
I'm gonna say Sasha just because Sasha still should be the top dog there. But
she should be, and I would like to see it. And, I mean, she looked pretty good last week against her. That whole thing went down, but I'm still going to say Nia, man. I feel like it's going to look like Sasha, and then out of nowhere, Nia's just going to sit on her, and boom, that's it.
And I guess they really should start bringing in more faces,
Second match on the pre-show, which we will not be watching. I don't give a fuck about the pre-show. But, funny enough, Cesaro and Sheamus will be defending the Tag Team Championships
on the
pre-show.
That's a fucking shame,
right? The other, just maybe, but not even, it felt like yesterday, they dethroned the New Day, and here they are on the fucking pre-show. Yeah.
Who are they defending against?
Take a guess. Who's pre-show worthy these days?
Oh, wow. Are they doing it with the club?
Yes.
Jesus. To be fair, this is a combined show. And
give me a break.
And you have all these titles to defend with the Royal Rumble match. You gotta kind of cut them a little.
I'm looking at this list. You could have put Rich Swann and Neville in the fucking pre-show, dude. Right, if you're gonna go down that route, you could have left Naya, and fucking Sasha. But then
you do that and you kill any little shred of credibility that the Cruiserweights have. That was
like, it has credibility since fucking when? Yeah, when did this happen?
That is another ship that has sailed.
Are you fucking serious?
There is no saving. I didn't even know that was on the card for the Rumble.
Yes,
and I'm just like, why?
Yeah, Cruiserweights are beyond saving.
Keep that shit on fucking Twitter. Five, dude, no one gives a fuck. Even with the Rumble being a sweet new heel, no one gives a fuck. Nah.
Cesaro win it.
Yeah, because the club can't win anything.
You know
I'm going to be the voice of dissent and say the fucking club.
You know what? I'm going to join you because fuck Cesaro, dude.
Fuck Cesaro. I hope they lose their titles on a fucking pre-show match. Yeah.
They should. They should lose their fucking match
or their belts on the pre-show. WWE composite tag team of two singles guys who are not really doing shit by themselves. So.
Almost every tag team that's ever existed is a composite tag team at some point.
I mean, yes and no. Like, these guys, by composite tag team, I mean, these guys are, like, established, well-established singles
guys. These guys were literally in a best-of-seven match.
Yeah. These guys were well-established singles guys who couldn't really do much on their own, and were kind of, like, floundering, and they're like, well, you know what, let's just put them together, because this is a holdover from last year's era of putting everyone together who wasn't doing well.
But, I mean, that doesn't necessarily mean that there should be a knock on a tag team.
It's like the League of Nations, and that shit with Bo Dallas and those guys, what the fuck do they call themselves?
The Social Outcasts?
Yes.
Well, yeah. I mean,
and all that nonsense. Like, this is a holdover from that.
But, I mean, like, you can get good tag teams out of that. At one point, fucking El Generico and Kevin Steen were a tag team.
Yeah, okay. Again, that's out of the dub, and I'm not saying that
Real Americans were a composite tag team, and they were fucking great.
Also, Cesaro's a really good tag team guy.
There's really not much.
But the point being, I understand what he's coming from. They were literally created because they were in a best of seven.
Yeah, they were created out of necessity because both of them weren't doing so well. That's what I'm saying. I'm not talking about, like, teams outside
of
the company.
That's kind of how any tag team gets put together, because guys weren't doing so well in the singles.
Not always, no. I mean, like, I'm not saying that it's without precedent. I'm just saying, like, this is a very glaring example of, like no one gave a fuck about Sheamus. Cesaro, after Tyson got hurt, like, I mean, Cesaro was doing better than Sheamus was, but he was really kind of, like, stagnating, too. So, like, it's like, well, let's just slap them together.
You're saying that as the only mark against them. They've been doing good stuff.
No, they're doing fine. Yeah. I'm just saying, it's not like, okay, if they were the only composite tag team, or one of few, that would be fine. But this has been like a thing. I mean, look at SmackDown with fucking Rhino and Heath Slater. You know?
Again, that was good stuff.
Yeah, that was fine. Yeah. The gimmick was fun and all that, but like, they took two guys who by themselves weren't really doing shit, and then put them together to make something out of them, because they weren't doing anything on their own.
That's kind of what you're supposed to do.
I mean,
I don't know what you're getting at.
I'm not saying it's a bad practice. I'm just saying, like, relying on having the company's top two tag teams being composite tag teams, it doesn't look that great, especially when you have on both sides.
I would agree.
Especially when you have on both sides a bevy of, like, actual normal established tag teams that are not doing shit underneath them. That's just not a good look. It's the same thing with Randy Orton and Bray Wyatt. Like, Why throw the belts on them? Why make them a tag team? Like, there are established tag teams, the Vaudevillains, the Hype Bros.
Just because they're established tag teams, and I mean, they can do stuff with some other guys,
but just because they're established tag teams doesn't mean you should go away from what's hot and what's working.
I'm just saying, it's not a good look when you have like 10 tag teams between your two brands that aren't doing shit, and your top tag teams are just made up of singles guys that were singles guys like 6 months ago.
I agree.
Not a good look.
I agree with that on the
good practice, just not a good look.
I agree with him on the simple idea of why have real tag teams on the roster.
That's what I'm saying.
If you're just going to combine
Like, how does that make your tag division look? Like, you've got five tag teams that have been tag teams the whole time.
It's never been single tag division.
Never been single guys. They've been tag teams the whole time. They're not doing dick. And then you take two singles guys and
every tag team that. If you include NXT, every tag team that they have, except for the Usos, have all been singles guys. And have all
fired together. The point that I understand with him is that when Bray Wyatt and Randy and Cesaro were tag champs, literally both teams just got off of rivalries against each other, were pitted together to make a tag team and win the belts. And while you have actual tag teams that were training together...
That were building together. That were introduced as a tag team. That were built as a tag team from the
jump. Are you guys missing the whole story? The whole point of the story was that these guys couldn't get along, and these guys were so evenly matched that if you can't beat them, join
together. That's fine.
That's just a shitty way to get out of it. The causality is irrelevant.
That doesn't matter how they came to be. That's immaterial to the discussion. The fact of the matter is, you've got literally like 80% of the tag team division is pre-established tag teams. Not a couple guys that weren't doing so well, they threw them together out of necessity. These were just tag teams, straight up. But you decided to put...
None of these tag teams are just tag teams. Everybody was put together at some point, except for the Usos and Enzo and Cass.
But they are introduced... The Vaudevillains were introduced as a tag team.
They were singles guys.
They were... Two SmackDown... I'm not talking about NXT.
NXT counts. Not in the realm of the main roster.
No one cares about any of that. No one cares about what the Ascension was doing on NXT. Okay? None of that matters in the grand scheme of things. Okay? For the casual viewers and for everyone who's watching these events, these guys were introduced to the main roster as a tag team. Okay? In comparison to the other main roster guys who were introduced and well-established for years as singles wrestlers. They're single guys. Then they get thrown together out of necessity, and they put the straps on them ahead of like five other teams that are just normal tag teams.
Just being there doesn't give you the right to the title.
I'm not saying
no one cares about the shining stars.
I'm not saying that they have a right. They have to earn it like everybody else. I'm just saying it's not a good look for the company when you're ignoring all these guys and putting straps on composite tag teams. That's all I'm saying.
I think you're the only person who cares about that. No one cares
because they're not investing. And it's an easy cop. And the reason I say it's an easy cop-out is because you just see two guys who are good on their own. You throw them together.
They're good on their own.
The point that he's trying to drive across it. I get what he's saying.
I don't agree with what he's saying, though.
That's fine. But I agree with him because on the simple merit that right now, if Sheamus and Cesaro split up, they would be fine on their own. If Randy and Bray split up, they'd be fine on their own. Yeah, if American Alpha split up on their own right now, you wouldn't give a fuck about any of them.
But the difference is, they weren't doing shit. Like, Randy wasn't doing a goddamn thing by himself. He wasn't doing anything.
No, he wasn't doing anything.
He needed to be put somewhere. That's why they did it. Rhino wasn't doing shit.
They didn't need to win the tag belts.
Rhino wasn't doing a goddamn thing. Heath had his little angle where he was trying to get a contract, which was cool, and Rhino piggybacked off of that, but they weren't really doing anything by themselves, especially not Rhino. Bray was doing relatively well because he's Bray Wyatt. Randy needed that.
Well, okay? Bray, at that point, Bray Wyatt had no credibility because he couldn't win a big match to save his life.
In each of these situations, one guy was doing okay, and he was part of a group before. This is Heath, this is Bray, this is Cesaro. And then the other guy, this is Randy, this is Sheamus, this is Rhino, needed something to hold on to, because there was nothing going on. So they're like, let's just throw him with this guy, because he needs somebody too, kind of, but not as much as he does, and boom, champions. It's bullshit. That's all I'm saying.
I don't buy...
It's bullshit. It's not... Okay, it's not necessarily bullshit, it's just not a good look. Especially when you have, like, 10 other teams that are waiting in the wings who have been teams.
I don't understand why that matters. It doesn't matter. And the Sheamus and Cesaro story was a good story.
I'm not saying it was a bad story, Anthony. I'm just saying it seems like such a desperate move. It seems like a desperate move. It's not a strong-looking move. Like, it makes Sheamus look like shit, which, I mean, he is. But like, it illustrates that. Like, it makes, because then you immediately think to yourself, well, what was she, like, what would Sheamus be on his own, and what could he be doing? Nothing. He wouldn't be doing anything, and that's why he's here. What would Rhino be doing? Nothing, and that's why he's doing what he's doing. What's Randy doing? He's not doing a damn thing. I mean, he has star power, but there's no relevant storyline. He's not in the title picture. He's not doing anything. He's just chilling.
So, instead of making these composite teams and going with a hot storyline, you'd rather just them throw the belts at the Vaudevillains or the Shining Stars or people that nobody gives a damn.
Work at trying to make these guys run.
Build your teams. Put that effort into building your teams.
I agree that they should do that too, but I don't think that Sheamus and Cesaro or Heath Slater and Rhino are necessarily a bad thing.
I'm not saying that they're a bad thing, and I'm not saying that it has to be so binary as instead of going with the hot hand, you just throw it at some undeserving team. I'm not saying that either. But I'm saying that, like, in the grand scheme of things, they could have went about this differently. They could have taken that effort and put it into building these smaller teams and making them relevant.
Yeah.
Instead of just giving up on them, not giving them any screen time, and then just going with an aging vet and a younger guy. And they're throwing the belts on them for whatever reason.
I think what he's frustrated about and what I'm frustrated about are sort of the same thing, is the simple fact that you have a tag team division, guys who are dedicated to being a tag team together, but they're taking a back seat. And I understand the whole hot, like, you have to go with hot, but it's the fact that why have a tag division and have guys who have been working together, and they came up together, and they, like, the Ascension came into WWE together.
No, they didn't. Well, to the main roster.
To the main roster. Not NXT. Yeah. We're not talking about main roster.
Before the main roster,
When they walked onto SmackDown, they were, the Ascension was together, American Alpha was together, Vaudevillains are together. The Hype Bros, yeah. Even though they could do fine on their own. Zack Ryder could do alone.
Yeah, he was fine.
But it's the simple merit that, why have a tag division when you're just going to override it with guys who were okay alone? I mean, they weren't doing anything, but if anything, they don't need to get involved in the tag titles. Like, they could just be a team and fight other teams, but why have a division dedicated to tag teams when the whole purpose of being a tag team is the chemistry and the cycle?
Like, you're not legitimizing your tag division. Yeah, you're taking away from it by doing that. And let's face it, not all these storylines were hot either. Like, the whole Sheamus Cesaro thing was boring as fuck. That was excruciating, sitting through those seven matches. Like, nobody cared.
The end of it was cool, and then them coming together.
The end of it was cool, but
yeah, but it took us like 8 months to get there. You know, and we bitched about it the whole time. Yeah. We have the record to prove it. It wasn't great.
This is essentially rated RKO all over again. It's two guys who are megastars, Edge and fucking Randy Orton, and you just threw them together just to fucking sell a shirt, you know?
Yeah, just to do it. Except, like, in this case, they took the ball and ran with it and actually put the fucking straps on them.
Yeah.
You know, which just makes the whole tag division look like shit. It looks like a desperate move. It looks like a grab. Yeah. That's what it looks like.
With Wyatt and Orton, I feel like with Sheamus and Cesaro, I guess because Raw is kind of lacking. I mean, you could have gave it to the club or whatever because they're a real tag team. But with Sheamus and Cesaro, there's no inner workings and no one's trying to, like, really kill each other off. With the Wyatt family, they held the belts for a month?
Yeah, if that. You know, like,
Why build that superstar tag team if you're just gonna let them?
And
like, I understand the dissension is a part of it, but it doesn't give any credibility to tag division.
In the case of, like, Randy and Bray, it was such an abrupt move. You know, out of nowhere.
You
have this massive feud.
The Wyatts were just a thing to get a heel transition from Heath Slater and Rhino to American Alpha.
I know, but that's, like, that transitional championship, like, it's such an obvious move. It's such an obvious grab because it's out of necessity, and it's so glaringly out of necessity.
I feel like that's what's killing the product for WWE, and as a whole, not Raw and SmackDown, as a whole, is this whole, we need black, we need white. So what you just said, the transition, why? Just have...
And this whole...
Like, Rhino and Rhino and Slater face off against American Alpha.
Taking guys that aren't doing so well and just packaging them together in these, like, these groups, like the Social Outcast, like the League.
Yeah, like, that stuff was bad.
Yeah, I feel like this is more of an offshoot of that kind of thinking, you know, like, oh, he's not doing so well, let's just put them together and make a sandwich.
I mean, I I understand what you're saying. I understand that it's a lot of times it doesn't look good. But, I mean, sometimes, like, you've got these guys on the payroll. Like, you got to kind of figure out something to do with them and just kind of throw everything at the wall and see what
sticks. I'm not saying it's a bad move from the business aspect. Yeah. I'm not saying it's a bad... I'm not even necessarily saying it's a bad move from a booking aspect. Yeah. I'm just saying that, appearance-wise, it just doesn't look good. And it makes the product look dumb. Yeah. At least for the rest of the tag division.
I don't know. Maybe they should put more emphasis on... Now that you've got the star power of Cesaro and Sheamus.
Yeah.
They have a good gimmick.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's just the way it came about.
And they work well together, you know. Yeah.
They should be trying to, while they're being the top tag team, working in new tag talents to eventually unseat them.
Of course.
Yeah.
Like, that's...
Like, the club.
Yeah.
Who have just been hanging out and catering.
For a year. Yeah. What? You know, while they're focusing on Sheamus and... Come on, man.
Quick question, while we're on the topic of tag teams. The club, the vaudevillains, the fucking fashion police, okay? What the fuck did these guys do to deserve any of this? What the fuck did they
do? They're all vanilla midgets?
What did the what was the point of leaving Japan to come to the WWE to do
virtually Again, and I said this on multiple podcasts. If Vince McMahon didn't make it himself... He will do everything in his power.
They had...
Even bringing the talent over, paying them money to kill whatever is hot that he didn't create.
So. It sucks because they could have been used... You know what? At the end of this, I honestly want Carl Anderson to go off on his own. No. Luke Gallows is alright, but fuck me, man. Like, he's very cringy. Carl Anderson is...
And you know what? Hopefully going to the first team that really, like, took the ball and ran with it with this whole ideal... was the New Day. All three of these guys weren't doing a goddamn thing by themselves. Yeah. They all sucked.
They got super over.
And they threw them together. It took off way more than anyone expected, eventually. I mean, it sucked at first. But took off huge, and they figured we can apply...
They weren't the first team to do that.
Not the first ever.
Because Americans did that, too.
Not the first ever. I'm just saying...
Team Hell No did that, too.
I'm just saying, like, in the last three years, like...
They're probably the biggest success story of all
That took off, and, like, that was, like, the beginning of this. They're like, let's just apply the formula, you know? A plus B plus C equals D.
I do think it's a lost art of finding actual tag teams and pitting them against
other tag teams. Well, tag teams have kind of been dead for, like, legit tag teams. Oh, yeah,
obviously.
Yeah.
That's the WWE formula.
You got guys who aren't doing a goddamn thing. Put them as a team. Put them out there. Well, let's see what happens.
They're not working. Let's package them together.
And it's also kind of like we're paying the price with having all this television programming, because now, like, in the territory days, like, they would just show up in your territory as a tag team, and then you'd read in the paper or whatever. Now, like, you see these guys from developmental, like, go through five different gimmicks, have a tag team partner they've never heard of, or two guys are like in the case of, in an American Office case, like, Chad Gable was kind of, he had a couple of matches, and Jason Jordan was kind of floundering, put them together.
They're awesome, yeah.
You don't have guys that, like, you just knew as tag teams. Like, except for the Usos, and Enzo and Cass came in together, I believe. But other than that, now with all this television, everybody's overexposed.
True.
It's a lot harder to...
What he was trying to convey is getting on to the main roster. This is the big time.
I don't count the NXT stuff.
Yeah.
I'm saying, as far as everyone who's watching Raw and SmackDown is concerned, these guys were introduced as a tag team. And none of them are doing anything. But meanwhile, you have well-established 5-10-plus-year guys that are being thrown into these, like, random-ass tag teams that have nothing to do with each other.
What the fuck did the Ascension do to deserve this? What the fuck did they do to
get this treatment? I think it's more or less what didn't they do to not make it?
They're an okay gimmick. I like their gimmick. I don't hate the Ascension. I don't know what's wrong with them. Personally, I like them, too.
They didn't make a big enough splash when they got called up and then just got forgotten about.
Well, if they weren't fed to, like, old fucking guys, fucking, like, the NWO and, like, the New Age Outlaws, give me a fucking break,
The whole thing, it feels a lot like when Samoa Joe and fucking Finn teamed up. to do the whole Dusty Rhodes thing.
Yeah, well, that whole thing was just a long-winded thing to set up their feud.
Yeah.
Literally just, I'm saying, like, throwing two big guys together just for the sake of doing it. Like, that feel, it just feels so, like ingenuine, I guess.
It feels processed.
It feels forced. It feels, I mean, and some teams do it better than others, you know? Like, Heath and Rhino had a nice little thing going on.
Yeah.
Cesaro and Sheamus have a better thing than they did originally.
And I think with Cesaro, like, the formula's there for him. Like, it's established that he makes guys. Like, he made fucking, what's his name? All-American Dude list.
Jack Swagger.
He made Jack Swagger. He made Tyson Kidd, although I think if given the chance, Tyson Kidd really could have shined
on his own. Once again, Tyson wasn't doing anything.
Same
thing.
But yeah, I just hate the composite tag team. Let's just throw these guys together. They didn't work as separate, you know, so the sum will be, like, greater than the parts. That whole ideal, it's tired, and I'm just sick of them doing it. Like, you have enough tag teams. You have enough of that shit. If anything, they need more singles guys. Like, they're fucking, the top cards of both brands are starving, okay? Like, SmackDown's doing a little bit better now that Cena's back, and Dean's not in the picture, because that was getting old as fuck, but the top cards need to expand. They need more guys.
Yeah.
Alright, like you said, 46-year-old Jericho shouldn't be carrying your fucking show and carrying Kevin on his back.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like, it shouldn't be those two and Roman.
Yeah.
At the top. Like, Seth's barely even in it at this point, because he's just so focused on the game from, like, 5 months ago.
Yeah.
Like, it's dumb
and
shit.
And being a terrible
baby. You know what I'm saying? These top cards need something, and they have the guys.
You're right about
They're just all locked in tag teams and groups and shit.
They really do need to...
They need to break some of that up.
They do need to put an emphasis on establishing the tag teams they already have and trying to make something out of some of them.
Yeah, break some of this shit up and flesh your singles game out, you know?
If you, because we really got to get to the main show.
Yeah.
If you just treat the tag division as if what it is, it is only tag teams, only guys that know their own partner, the only guys that have been on the road together forever, or guys that were put together and became a unit together, lower, not on WWE television. It's supposed to be exclusive. It cannot be guys who are like, you and me hate each other, but I guess we could try a hand on the tag.
Or, hey,
it just sounds like an evil cop-out.
You want to get the tag belts? Yeah. Yeah, sure, all right.
Yeah, it's supposed to be an exclusive. I feel like it's supposed to be an exclusive class where just guys, like I said, tag teams, strict tag teams only.
Like, you're a tag team or you're not. Like, you can't, don't.
Let's leave it at that, though. Yeah. I'm sure we can go on about this for ages.
So, the main show. The Royal Rumble itself.
After we spent, 20 minutes
debating on composite tag teams, which is a pretty hot topic at the moment. It doesn't make any sense. But anyways, we have the 3-on-3 six woman tag match, which was thrown together because everyone hates each other.
Yeah.
Becky Lynch, Nikki Bella, Naomi, the faces, versus the evil Alexa Bliss, Mickey James, and Natalya. I'm gonna see Team Heel just to keep the momentum
just
going.
Just for the heat.
There's no belt on the line.
Champs
you don't really
on the
need
team.
To,
keep
you don't need
strong,
to make the heels or the faces look good at for
no.
any reason.
For the reason that you said that no belt on the line, I'm actually gonna say the baby faces, because Alexa doesn't have to, you can still have Alexa hold the title belt and lose a match.
But with the whole Mickey James, Alexa Bliss theme you've got going on right now, I would feel like they'd want to keep that moving, so
I guess.
I'll go heels.
I'm gonna say baby faces, but I understand what you're saying with the heels.
Yeah. I'll say heels, just because it gives you, you know, it gives you fuel to the fire.
Yeah.
You know, for all three rivalries, it gives you some, it gives you something to do,
this is on the card, by the way. Rich Swann versus Neville.
Which is ridiculous.
I'm going to say Neville because I feel like they're going to be building up this guy.
Please let this be the opening match of the Rumble. Like,
it's not. It's apparently... Okay, this is this was the card that was given on the internet. I don't know if this is an exact order, but yeah, like you just said, I hope this is the beginning. So, what did we all say here? I said Neville.
Neville.
We all said Neville, right?
Yeah.
Okay, we all want Neville to win because of credibility.
Yeah, of course.
Charlotte Flair... By the way, Flair versus Cringy Bailey. Oh, the super fan. How dare she like wrestling?
This is actually a pretty good one. I mean, not a good match, but I mean, like, it's a It's kind of a toss up.
Like, no, it's not. It's a pay per view. It's not a toss up.
It's Charlotte.
Yeah, no, you're right.
Charlotte's taking it all because she can't lose at events.
Yeah.
So it will be Charlotte winning. We all agree, yeah. Charlotte, right? Yeah. Okay, because she can't lose right now. I don't really.
Pay per view bumps her like power level up.
Yeah,
that's true. But what if Bayley knocked her off and then we get?
It won't be until Mania.
I think it'd be WrestleMania. Where this
maybe
happens.
A little Sasha Bayley for Mania after like a little blow off at Fastlane or whatever for Charlotte.
Charlotte versus the crazed wrestling fan Bayley at WrestleMania. That's going to be the situation.
Okay.
Now here's a very interesting one: AJ Styles versus John Cena.
This is going to be the better of the two, obviously. The two like big belt matches.
This is going to be the best title match on the entire card.
This might be the flyest match of the entire night, honestly. So
do we go with John tying the record, or do we go? We continue with the AJ Styles movement.
I gotta say, Cena. I think it's.
I would like to give a prediction, but I really don't know what's going to happen. Yeah. I don't know where they're going to go with this. This is essentially setting up WrestleMania, and because we don't know anything about WrestleMania, we don't know anything about this match.
It's tough, because, like, okay, originally my thoughts were, and this is kind of like throwing, I mean, originally, so it's not necessarily my thoughts for a Rumble, but I was thinking Cena goes over, Taker wins a Rumble, sets up for Cena, Taker, and Mania, which is probably the easiest prediction to make, because that would be a really easy way to go. It'd be a really big match, Cena and Taker, you know, like...
Before that, who's winning the match?
Yeah, I know. I know. But I'm saying, I'm not getting to that. That's not my Rumble prediction. Okay. I'm just saying, originally, that's what I thought was going to happen.
Okay.
But since the Rumble itself is so up in the air, and I haven't really made up my mind on that, it's tough, man, but I still think Cena's going to take it. Just because of the way they've been building it, and, you know.
Just for the simple fact that they wanna copy Wrestle Kingdom, which they could try, they won't get there. But if they're going down that route of having the best talent for the titles, I'm gonna say AJ keeps it. Just for the simple fact that it'll prolong the John Cena
thing,
and AJ finally gets to defend the belt. We do have Elimination Chamber on the way there, so this is probably not going to be set in stone. Yeah. But I will go AJ just for the simple fact that if we're going to have a main event that's worthy of calling it better than Wrestle Kingdom, you need AJ Styles.
But that means Styles goes over Cena for a fourth time.
AJ Styles really is the best wrestler?
He is, but you really think you're going to let him go over Cena again? After the hiatus?
We're talking about the WWE. You really have to stop using best wrestler as an excuse for things.
Yeah.
Best wrestler does not play in.
It's so hard for me to do. I judge people on their talent.
You have to, when we're making predictions, you can't talk about how you would book it. How you think they're going to book it.
You got to think about what's best for business. And
Anthony.
Obviously, AJ would win in a normal situation.
Yeah.
So you're going Cena? I'm going AJ.
Cena.
So two Cena. One hopeful AJ.
Hey, don't get me wrong. I would love for AJ to win this thing, but
I'm going to go against, like I just said, if they're willing to really think about this whole, we want WrestleMania to be a very good marquee match, I'm going to say AJ Styles because he's the best wrestler on the planet at the moment, and probably because they know that because of the reaction he gets. But
honestly, like, if AJ does win, it maintains the status quo, and you still have another opportunity to take it off of him before Mania if you really wanted to. If Cena wins, you really can't have anybody else take that belt from him.
No. Yeah,
that's not Styles or someone like Undertaker. Well, Styles,
if the power creep does happen, AJ has to win.
You know,
because he's the only one to defeat him clean in the middle of the ring.
Yeah.
Kevin Owens versus Roman Reigns with Jericho in the Sharkcage with no disqualification. I will just say Roman Reigns.
Yeah, I must say, regrettably, I think we all know how this is going
to
end.
I don't think Kevin's going to has any sort of opportunity to get out of there without the belt.
And you know what? I know not a lot of people are going to say it, but take the belt off him. Get it off him. He doesn't need it anymore.
Not the way he is now.
Yeah.
No, not like
Let him do something else and reestablish himself.
Yeah, please, because
if you would have asked me who the Universal Champion was since Balor left, I would have said it's a toss-up between Jericho and Roman Reigns. Kevin Owens is non-existent in this entire Roman Reigns Y2J show. I'm sorry. It sucks, really, because we love
Kevin Owens.
Yeah, but he hasn't done a goddamn. It was such an amazing moment when he got the belt. It was like a fucking fairy tale, man.
It faded away rather quickly.
It was fantastic, and then
one week later,
such shit so quick.
Yeah. What do we think is going to happen with this whole Sharkcage thing? Is Jericho going to be up there for the whole time, or probably, is he going to get?
Yeah, I don't see him descending. I mean, because it's going to be up there. Like, it's going to be like 20 feet in the air. Like, there's no way he's jumping down from there.
Yeah,
unless they lower the fucking thing. Like, he's not getting out of the cage, but he will definitely drop something into the ring.
Oh yeah.
A la Takeover.
I do predict that they're going to go the exact same road as Takeover drop something from the cage.
They're already doing the same gimmick. Why not? You know?
And you add the note. You're basically giving that away by saying no disqualification. Because once again, Roman Reigns is a babyface. He does not cheat.
He's going to drop his fucking scarf or something there and let him choke him with it. Yeah, whatever.
We've got this all figured out. They can't do anything. Now, the big match, which I am personally excited for, and I honestly am excited for a lot of different reasons. There's a lot of things that can happen. I don't know what's going to happen, and I don't know who's going to win it. I don't know who's going to be in it, but the Royal Rumble match. Here's the million-dollar question. Who's winning the Royal Rumble?
That is super tough.
You know what? For the simple fact that we are not going to see it coming, I will go with Sami Zayn.
Sami Zayn sounds like a good idea.
Yeah,
we're pulling for Sami here.
I really think it should be Sami, but
you have a business prediction here. I think that's business. I'm not saying that because I want him to.
No, I don't know. Like, well, I kind of read, not necessarily a spoiler, but an idea of where they may go. But despite all that, I think I'm still gonna say Sami, but. We didn't talk about it. We said we were going to talk about it beforehand. The Kenny Omega news, which ties into this.
That's right.
Kenny Omega said today that, or technically yesterday, because now it's early in the morning, but he said that he will not be signing with the WWE, and he will be returning to New Japan.
New Japan for at least a year.
Yeah, at least a year. And he's going to be flying back in February to renegotiate his contract. But
we'll talk about that after the Rumble or the Rumble match.
No, this is tying into my prediction.
That's why I want to go on now. Go on.
Part of me thinks it's a work. So part of me still thinks he's going to show up. And there's even a little part of me that thinks that he could win it.
Tough. That's a very bold prediction.
And if Cena wins the belt, AJ wins it back at Elimination Chamber, AJ Styles, Kenny Omega, WrestleMania,
book it right now. So you're going, that's business. That's not what you want. That's business. That's what's technically, what you feel is going to happen because of WWE.
No, I still think Sami Zayn, but there's just a little piece of
There's no safe predictions here. This is either
all right, business. I'm putting it out there. I could be way off, but Kenny Omega.
Kenny Omega.
Winning the Royal Rumble.
You heard it here, folks.
Dude, you totally took my first pick. But I'm going to go with my second, Undertaker.
Well, we can have the same pick.
Yeah, no. I know.
It gives up a pick.
I mean, he did it in extravagant fashion, so I'm not going to take that credit. I would love to see it, and I still think it's going to happen. But as far as like a practical, like what I actually think is going to happen, Undertaker.
Nah.
Undertaker. Because no matter what, if it's Cena or AJ, that sets up for a massive match at WrestleMania. So.
I will join you with Taker being the safe net. I will say Sammy, Taker's the safe net. I don't have a third. I don't know. And Lesnar and Goldberg aren't winning it.
No. They're going to be too wrapped up in each other.
It's a nice idea, but
they're already booked for Mania, aren't they?
Yeah.
So,
yeah,
obviously not.
It's going to happen either way.
Yeah, but I'd say Taker is probably the odds on favorite, I guess, to win this thing. Or, Dark Horse, maybe Braun takes it.
No.
I don't know. I really want to buy into what Triple H says about not seeing it coming, so I think people see Braun coming, or they see Undertaker coming, so
they won't see Sammy.
Undertaker for sure.
Yeah. The reason I think Sami Zayn's a little more under the radar, and of course Kenny Omega is obviously under the radar.
If Kenny comes out at number 30, I'll shit my pants.
No matter what number he comes out at.
Yeah, that would be fucking insane.
So Tyson goes, Sammy winning it overall, business-wise, Taker's the safe net. I will do the exact same. I will clone his prediction. Anthony's going big with Kenny Omega.
Kenny Omega.
Guy who hasn't even been signed to the company is going to win it all at the Royal Rumble.
Which would be Titty City.
Would be amazing, but
I mean, I think I do lean more Sami Zayn, but I would love the whole Kenny Omega thing. Think Sami Zayn comes out at number one?
At number one?
Yeah.
He'll come low. Yeah. I don't know about number one.
I don't know about number one, but he'll definitely, I agree. He'll definitely be under 10.
You know what's intriguing about them that you just brought it up? So Sammy has to work for all of this. He's worked for literally everything.
Yeah. I think that because of all that, and they haven't, because usually they make some stupid stip to give some guy that doesn't like number one.
Yeah.
I think Sami Zayn's a perfect candidate.
So Sammy had to work for his spot in the Rumble. He goes number one. Let's say he wins it all. Guess what? You don't have to talk about Chris Benoit anymore at being a number one.
Well, they'll still have to talk about him because he's still one of two people to do it.
But that'll add to the whole, we only have two guys that wanted from number one. So it's like we get to erase Chris Benoit from the history books.
It's still an erase.
I know, but that's but
now
the...
Now we have two other guys to talk about.
Yeah, we have two guys that we can talk about. We could say, and Shawn Michaels, you know, the Alamo Dome and the whole San Antonio thing.
I think, and this is something that I'm the most positive on as far as gut feeling predictions, is that I think Sami Zayn will be number one, and even if he does win it, he's going to be within the last four guys.
Yeah.
He's going to go...
He'll be there for a while.
He's going to go pretty much all the way.
Oh, yeah.
He's going to be the Iron Man.
I do believe that he will eliminate Braun.
I think that's what
And I think he'll challenge Rey Mysterio. Rey Mysterio has a time record, right? 62 minutes?
Yeah.
Yeah. I think he'll challenge that.
If not Rey, I think Benoit is a second close.
I think Mysterio is out at number two, I think, in that one.
Yeah.
But I think Mysterio has the most time for being in the Rumble, but I think it's Michaels and Benoit that did it from number one.
Word.
Either way, this will be a very interesting Rumble. I'm actually... I feel like they're going to let me down, man. I really do. They do every year, but I'm actually very hopeful about this Rumble, and I feel like... They've done a great job of not saying anything.
I think there's a lot of ways that they can go that won't be necessarily disappointing. I mean, there will be ones that we obviously want more than others, but I think that there will be a lot of ways they can go that'll be like, oh, that makes sense.
That at least won't be predictable.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And for, you know, it's funny, like, considering how many guys that they've shown in this Rumble, there's still a lot of, like, dark areas here. There's still a lot of unpredictability to this.
Well, yeah.
So
there's still, like, gotta save some spots for returns for Blue Meanie and...
But I don't think they've ever advertised...
Yeah, Kurt Angle. I forgot about
such
him.
Such a bulk of the competitors.
Magnus.
Well, now that Mickey James is signed...
Thing they said about Velvet Sky. Now that Bubba's here.
But yeah, now that Mickey James is signed, they didn't get Magnus signed, but Johnny Gargano was signed, they didn't get Candice LeRae.
So, Royal Rumble 2017, the card itself sucks, but the Royal Rumble match is going to be the most anticipated thing, and we will...
Yeah, and that's what everyone watches the Rumble for anyway.
Yeah,
guys, I think you forgot a match.
What? What did we miss?
No, they're in the fucking thing.
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
Watch it.
It's the way they've been building it, you would think that they'd have
their own match. Yeah, they should. It's late. Tyson's been drinking.
Lesnar Goldberg.
Oh, yeah. Lesnar Goldberg? Really?
They had a match? Yeah, I It's all right. It's 2:34, gentlemen and ladies who are watching this out there.
This is an extremely star-studded event, obviously, because they're in the Alamo Dome, they need bigger faces, they need to fill seats. So, fun fact, though, before we get onto the Kenny Omega stuff, the last time the Royal Rumble was in San Antonio, The Undertaker won the Royal Rumble, 2007, 10 years ago. He won the Royal Rumble. This was not in the Alamo Dome, but it was in San Antonio, where the Spurs play. I forgot the arena name. But, fun fact for the day. Now, Kenny Omega, officially announcing that he's re-signing with the New Japan for another year. The details...
Well, he said he wants to. It's not official.
He wants to. They're shooting for a one-year deal here. Now, this was the big thing. This was the biggest story going into the Rumble, whether he would show up, whether he wouldn't show up. And... I would like to point out that if he does stay, which I think he's going to end up staying, he's not going to the WWE. I mean, I know a lot of people are going to be let down by this situation, but...
Like logically, you're right. You're right. This probably.
Logically speaking, and not only that, but I would want to see Okada Omega play out even further. I do not want this to end. Kenny Omega does not need the WWE The WWE has way too much talent.
Yeah.
First of all, they're overstaffed
after
the moment.
After the success of their last match, I'd like to see more of him.
But that's not happening. That we're not going to see Okada and Naito.
Here's the
Omega,
reason why.
At least not for the title.
Here's the reason why I think he's going to.
I don't think so.
Here's the reason why I think he's going to stay put. And the reason he's going to stay put is because this whole fiasco of going to the WWE and doing interviews in the States and talking
to Meltzer. You think it's a big publicity thing?
No. Not publicity, yeah. Positive publicity. And to get his name out there, one, two. To force the hand of New Japan. Because if you listen to any of his interviews, he wasn't so sure on his status with the company. So he had the big match with Okada. And I think along the lines, they said, well, you're not going to be in the title picture for the 2017. They're going to go in a different direction. He goes, well, I could go to WWE and fuck you over. You do have a California show in the summer. You need a good American. Yeah. Well, he's not American, but a good name for the American shows.
Yeah.
How about I just leave you?
Well, they already have a good name. They have Cody Rhodes. They can fall back on.
I mean, Kenny Omega's worth at least three Cody Rhodes.
Yeah, Cody's
good. Three Cody Rhodes.
Cody's good, but he doesn't have the established
name as Kenny.
Yeah, Kenny Omega's a legit star in New Japan at the moment.
Cody's good, but I feel like he's not going to be as big as Kenny.
Yeah.
No.
But yeah, I don't think that if Omega does resign, I don't think that he's going to be in the title picture, because I think that Minoru Suzuki is winning the belt at New Beginning, and I think him and Suzuki-gun are going to dominate New Japan for 2017.
That's why I said Kenny. I feel like this was all...
That's why I don't know why Kenny Omega would go back. And I think this is if there ever was a time, this is the time to jump.
But this is also his opportunity to sway them into putting him in the title picture. He goes, look, I will resign, but you need to put me in that title picture.
But
I will not come back if I'm not in the main title picture.
This is the biggest star Kenny Omega's ever been. I think he can maximize it.
Remember when the club came over and we thought they were going to be the shit?
Kenny Omega's bigger than Carl Anderson and Luke Gallows.
Yeah, but it's the WWE cog that's...
And I think...
Untrustworthy
that,
of
I think
Kenny Omega's appearance.
Kenny Omega's star power is almost as big as AJ's. I think he will, no matter what they try to, like, if they try to kill him, you can't kill Kenny Omega.
Yeah.
And I think that if he comes in and wins the Rumble, AJ gets the belt back at Elimination Chamber. AJ Kenny Omega is a great, and they want to rival Kenny Omega Okada. The best way they can rival is by taking one of the fucking guys.
Yeah, true. Take one half of the equation and throw him against an equal or bigger star, depending on how you look at it.
And it has a built-in storyline of both being former big guys in the Bullet Club.
Well, we will end this with
the big pop.
It would be insane.
This has too much momentum for it to not happen. I think this is... for both sides.
But then again, we're talking about the dog.
I know.
Murphy's Law and all that.
There's a lot of hot air when it comes to WWE. There's a lot of things. The beauty of it all is the speculation. And like I said, I came down to earth a long time ago, even when this started. And I said, Kenny's resigning because he still has unfinished.
I felt that way too until recently.
He has unfinished business with the championship. One, two, this is his perfect opportunity to say, look, I could go to WWE right now. You can't stop me. Unless you put me in the title picture. It's a good way to blackmail. Not blackmail, but to sway. That's why they haven't worked out a deal yet. He hasn't signed a deal yet. They're still working on a deal. This is his angle to work out a better deal and a better future and a better outcome for his character. And, by the way, they're coming to America. So, they need Kenny Omega. He has a lot of weight at the moment.
Kenny Omega doesn't need them, though.
No, but with his style of wrestling, here's the thing. I love Kenny Omega enough to say that he's perfect for New Japan because WWE... AJ's amazing. I'm not saying AJ floundered or anything. He hasn't sucked one bit. It's just... If you listen to any of his interviews with Meltzer, he is still very much a part... He still likes this style of wrestling. He still likes the Japanese style of wrestling where it's physical, it's competitive, and it's a sport. And you come over to WWE and It's not that anymore. It's nothing like that anymore. So Kenny Omega, I feel like Kenny, it's a good way to get his name out there. This is perfect. I mean, he's dominating the wrestling world at the moment, and he's not even signed to WWE. But I feel like Kenny needs to stay in New Japan. I'm sorry. I don't give a fuck.
I don't know. Just
about WWE. It would be a nice, if he just came out for the Rumble, it'd be great and went back to Japan. But why would you waste an appearance on a loss in the Royal Rumble?
I get what you're saying, and I agree with that. But if I'm Kenny Omega, this may be the hottest I'll ever be. I would be a fool to not capitalize.
33 years old, he still has a couple more years to worry about.
And I mean, I get that, and he's looking for a one year deal. So he's betting on himself. He's in baseball terms, he's taking the qualifying offer, and he's playing for 1 year back for the team he was at. But this may be the hottest he ever is. If his contract ends at the same time next year, he may not have the same star power. He may not have the same leverage that he would have going into a contract negotiation.
I don't think anyone's going to forget about him, though.
No, he'll still be a hot topic.
He'll still be pretty hot next year. He won't be as hot, no.
Exactly, that's what I'm saying. He's coming
fresh off
the momentum. But I'm saying this is the max, the maximizing his leverage. But then
again, AJ wasn't as hot New Japan wise as when he came over. He wasn't as hot as he
was AJ Styles before him. AJ Styles was also a more established name for a longer period of time.
This is true.
Also, another thing, AJ used New Japan as a launch pad to eventually get into WWE, which is something I thought he really wanted to get a part of. He did the Bullet Club gimmick for a little bit to, reestablish himself. Kenny Omega is pretty content with Japan.
Yeah.
He loves Japan. He's made a name for himself, and that's him being loyal, because they need him.
I mean, and if he does that, I respect that. I just, from the business aspect,
Kenny Omega,
this is maximizing his this is the best he'll ever have.
Kenny Omega became Kenny Omega, and they put him in the spotlight because AJ Styles left. If someone gave you an opportunity because someone else left, why would you go with them immediately a year later? Loyalty wise, it doesn't seem right. It doesn't seem right, and of course, New Japan has a big year ahead of them with
the. But I also think that anybody in the wrestling industry understands that.
Obviously, but we're not Kenny Omega. Kenny Omega made his name in Japan, so that's been most of his work is in Japan. Here, too, in the States, but he's
made. But I mean, you could say that about any wrestler that before they came to WWE, they made their name somewhere else.
Kenny's got a different loyalty status, so. And he's got a different name for himself, and I really like this program with Okada. I don't want to see it end. I don't want him to come over to WWE and be the small fish in a large pond.
What's he going to do with Okada? Have another match for not the title?
No, for the belt. And that's,
they're not going to go that way. They're not going that way.
They have to.
They're not. Did you watch the end of
New Dash?
Yeah.
New Year's Dash? No, I didn't see New Year's Dash.
Yeah, no, they're going with Minoru Suzuki. They're going with the Suzuki-Gun angle. They're not. Omega and Okada are going to be on the shelf for now. And if they don't go with Minoru Suzuki, then they're dropping the ball.
Why would they put that on the shelf when that's like the hottest thing in wrestling right now? That match is like instant match of the year. Like, why would they can that?
Because then you wouldn't set up the Suzuki Okada feud it to not pay off.
I mean,
for the time being, I think Kenny's gonna get his shot eventually again.
Not right away.
I can't see them. Not
you need him, this and you need him for the U.S. shows. They're coming
for
over
all
here
the, for
to
all
the
same
States.
Reasons that he has the momentum to come over here. Or the same reasons he has momentum to go back against Okada. Like, he's hot. He's literally
the
top of the world
wrestling
right now. He's huge. Why wouldn't they go with him? He is arguably their biggest star right now.
It's not even an argument. He is their biggest star right now. But
So why wouldn't they keep him in title contention? Why wouldn't that? I mean, I'm sure whatever happened New Year's Dash precludes that they're going to go with Suzuki-Gun or whatever, but like, Why keep him in the dark? Like, why? Like, that would be such a bad move.
Well, then,
all the way around.
Then they really shouldn't waste Minoru Suzuki on, if they're not going to put the belt on him. Because I think that after they dominated the way they dominated Pro Wrestling Noah, and with the how far the Bullet Club's like star power has
fallen.
Crashed. I think that for the long term overall health of New Japan, that they need to let Suzuki-Gun dominate this year. But, I mean, I see what you're saying.
What's Omega going to do? He's just going to just chill out and, like.
That's why I think that Omega should jump now and I think that New Japan should hold to that.
Omega is their key to expanding. I understand the concept of keeping it within the Japanese wrestlers. I get it. They're over. They're your guys.
You know, it's not even necessarily keeping it Japanese. It's just I think that that is a really hot angle that they could go with and that they should go with and they shouldn't. That's
true. But you got to ask yourself, is it going to be hotter than anything they could do with Kenny?
Kenny is literally probably working on that right now.
Look into your heart, Anthony. You know it to be true.
He is literally literally holding off on signing probably for the very reason we're talking about right now. Yeah. Look, you guys are going to go with this guy. I want some action or else I'm out.
Yeah, because if you're Kenny Omega, you're not going to sit there and just take the back seat to some
and fade away in the mid-card.
Like, not now. Not when you just came off of this crazy match.
Unless you let Suzuki take the belt off. Hold Omega, like, sign Omega, but hold him off for a while and have Omega come back to face Suzuki. They could go that way.
Possibly. But I mean, right now, like, you gotta strike while the iron's hot, like you said. Yeah. And the iron has never been hotter for Omega.
Yeah.
So, I mean, if I was Omega, like, I'd go with whoever is willing to give me more screen time, more money.
And New Japan will give him a ton of screen time.
If New Japan's not willing to pony up, I'd make the jump. But, I mean, if they... I'm sure if Omega lays his balls on the table and is like, listen, put me in it or I'm bouncing, they will ride that so the wheels fall off.
We will conclude with this. I would be optimistic about him coming over, but I don't see, if he does come over, it won't be till after the Rumble. Because I feel like he's going to try to work something out. Maybe. And he wants Mania. Actually on the radio show with fucking Meltzer, he said he would loved to have been a part of Royal Rumble, but he's in the middle of negotiating.
It's just so much speculation, so much like hype, so much stuff in various media outlets.
It wouldn't make sense for him to make that jump while the iron's hot, only for him to not win the Royal Rumble.
I feel like you're teasing it too much, man. Like, between the Cena stuff on Instagram and the signing the stuff with number 30 and all
that. They're trying to sway him.
I feel like they're really swinging. They're teasing it too much. I feel like they pretty much almost have to do it at this point.
And I was going
to
say the thing that Seth Rollins said on the thing, but I think Anderson or Gallo said Ishii or something. And they mentioned a couple other stars that aren't
just WWE. They'll never come over,
So.
Well,
I don't know. I kind of really want it to happen.
I would love. I would.
It would be amazing. It would be absolutely hands down.
I think we would all love for a Omega to come.
The most. I will remember the fucking Rumble for sure.
Yeah, be welcome with open arms. Yeah. It'd be awesome.
So we will leave it all, but we will always take the safe bet and say Sami Zayn. I guess we could all collectively as a group.
I don't think necessarily Sami Zayn's a safe bet either, but it's a safer than Kenny Omega.
Undertaker, bro. Undertaker's like the safest bet around.
Safe net. Undertaker, a real winner. Sami Zayn. Obviously, Anthony's in a lot of land.
I'm still going to stick on Kenny Omega just for
Kenny Omega winning it all, taking it to WrestleMania, and beating AJ Styles for the championship.
Omega's our fantasy pick.
We will join you guys again on Sunday after the Rumble, and we will assess what we have just witnessed, and hopefully it will be definitely a Rumble to remember. So we will join you all once again on Sunday. Top guys out.